Okay, so in this second part, I want to point out the behavior of the solution of the logistic equation just in the interval 0, k. I forgot to put here 0 and k. So take a moment to write this down. On this interval, when the initial population is between 0 and k, we also provided a full solution, one of the few instances in which we're going to be able to actually solve explicitly the ODE. This is a type of a Bernoulli equation, so we can solve that explicitly. And this format of the solution exists only if a p-naught is between 0 and k for all time t. There is a little bit more to that. In this class, I don't want to go too deeply into the theory of differential equations, as I mentioned in the beginning. One of the problems is that once you actually solve an ODE, that's not necessarily defined for all time t. And you know, for the solution to make sense, it has to be basically defined for the time interval that you want to run the model with, essentially. So what happens is, in some cases, if you have an initial condition out of 0k, then you, and depending on the sine of r, you may have actually a vertical asymptote here, meaning that the solution is not defined for all time t. The theory of initial value problems of differential equations states that if I have an initial point, there is going to be a solution defined on a certain maximum interval of existence for t. That maximum interval of existence may not always be all time t. So as long as we start between 0 and k, we don't have these problems. This behavior here I have here on the left side is if r is greater than 0, and this is if r is less than 0, as we mentioned before. So in this case, p of t goes to k, p of t goes to 0. So this is how the graph looks like of the logistic equation solution between 0 and k. Notice that the growth rate actually looks kind of exponential in the beginning, and we'll talk about that more in the context of epidemic model soon enough. And then there's going to be an inflection point after which the solution approaches k asymptotically. And I should mention here that, again, if you don't care about what happens at any point in time t, but you only care about the limiting behavior, you don't need the explicit solution. So if you only want the limiting behavior, which is what we want most of the time anyway in these models, then you don't need, the explicit solution p of t. You only need the phase lineup we did in the previous part. That's one of the beauties about the theory of differential equations. You can say a lot of things about solutions without actually solving for the explicit solution, which is rather fortunate, because most of the time we cannot find that explicit solution. So one thing I want to point out again is the fact that the interpretation of this inflection point is rather important, because if you think about it, signifies the population level at which the limited resources start to have an effect on the population growth. So this inflection point is the size of the population above which the growth slows down. So let's go back actually to the interpretation of the second derivative or the inflection point from calculus 1. We have something called concavity, right, in calculus 1. So the first derivative, you know, p prime tells you whether the function increases or decreases, right? So p prime of t positive means that the function is increasing. P double prime, though, the concavity, tells you whether the growth rate, that derivative, is increasing at a faster rate, like the growth rate itself is increasing, or the growth rate is decreasing. So you still have a positive growth, but that growth itself starts to decrease until basically it reaches zero. So when you come basically very, very close to the asymptote, the derivative is nearly zero. Still positive, but, you know, asymptotically toward zero, which means p of t approaches k asymptotically. So this inflection point is very important, because when you analyze how the population increases, if you notice that the growth rate, while positive, starts to basically slow down, that signifies, at least in the context of our model, that the size of the population gets too big, or not too big, but big enough so that the limited resources effect starts to have an influence on the growth rate. So one of the nice things about models like this is that this inflection point can actually be computed without solving for the explicit equation, for the explicit solution. We can go back to the ODE itself and take another derivative on both sides. Remember, with the exception of R and K, everything is a function of P. So we do the product rule. So we have R, 1 prime is 0, minus 1 over K times 1, P plus R times 1 minus P over K times 1. We can factor R, and so we have minus P over K, and then plus 1 minus P over K. And so if I solve for the parentheses here, 1 minus 2p over k equals 0, then p equals k over 2. So again, let's not confuse with this p of t as a function of t. Let's call it p star to indicate this is a constant. So this is basically the population size at the inflection point. And we could have actually guessed that, if you think about, because the model is so basic, right? I mean, it's just essentially, depending on just one positive growth rate here, and there's nothing else besides the population and no other influences, no other terms. I mean, it's not a system of equations to have more interacting population terms. So simply this one says, if you basically get to half of the population, so this inflection point is k over 2. After that, the growth rate starts to decline. And it kind of makes sense, again, given this format of the equation. And of course, the opposite effect can happen here. This is a declining population, and then you could say that basically it declines slower in the beginning, but then faster later on. Most of the time, we're going to be basically dealing with this, because in many models, if we have enough resources, typically this growth rate is positive, right? I mean, under normal conditions with plentiful resources, population low, then you're going to have basically positive growth rate. That depends on the context, of course. I mean, depends on the problem at hand. So when do you use actually the explicit solution? Not too often. In this week we use it once or twice. Like, for example, let's give an example here. Suppose I have p prime equals 0.1 1 minus p over 100 times p. You should get used to recognize what constitutes r and k, and you should be able to use previous results. So once we solve logistic equation once, you don't have to do it again for the homework. Use directly the equation and just plug in the appropriate numbers. So for example here, P of T, the explicit solution is 1 over 1,000. Oh, I forgot to mention P-naught. Let's say P-naught is 10, the initial condition. So 1 over 100 plus 1 over 10 minus 1 over 100 e to the minus 0.1 t. So let's say, because we know the limiting behavior, right? We start with something between 0 and 100, p naught is 10. We know already that p of t goes to 100. But let's say that I want to know the time at which p of t reaches the size equal to 20, right? So somewhere between 10 and 100, the population should get to 20 people. And I want the exact time when that happens. And so for that, whenever you actually ask a question about the time, you need the explicit solution. If you cannot find the explicit solution, in general, it's not possible to tell what exactly the time is for a certain value of the population. You can talk about the limiting, what happens as t goes to infinity, but not the precise time. You can do this by hand, but you also need to use the calculator. You feel free to use Wolfram Alpha or any computer algebra system. So if you set p of t equals to 20 and solve for t, in this particular example, you should end up with t equals 8.1 years. Assuming, of course, the time unit is 100, is given in years. So that's an example of how to use the explicit solution. Again, we won't use it often from now on. One thing I want to mention, and that's very important before we move on to another part of today's lecture. And like, let's do it in the second part. You have to recognize, and let's actually write this as a remark because that's quite important. So get used to recognize the logistic equation in different contexts. So let's start with the standard one, right? When we have the way we wrote it here. Because by the way, one of the reasons it's written like that is because since it's important whether we start above or below k, when you run the phase line analysis, it's very easy to basically estimate the sign of this quantity, right? Because it's either above or below one. That's one of the reasons. But I mean, you can actually write it in various forms. I mean, one can, for example, maybe distribute r. So get used to recognize the logistic equation when you see a difference between a constant times p and another constant times p squared. So here's an equivalent example. Suppose you have x prime, let's say the dependent variable is x of t. X prime equals ax minus bx squared. This is also logistic. And with some experience, I mean, with some practice, notice that the coefficient of x stands for that r. Sometimes it has more than a single constant embedded to it. But, you know, if I compare the two, I know already that if a is greater than 0, then x of t approaches a over b. So it approaches... let me see if I... So it approaches basically the positive equilibrium size. Right? I mean, you could again do the, you could do the phase line analysis independently of what you did before with the logistic case. Again, you can, you know, factor this, find the equilibrium points 0 and in this case a over b. But you should already know from what you did in the logistic case that that's what you get. And get used to that so that you don't have to do it all over again. And obviously, if a is less than 0, then x of t approaches 0 if you start with positive initial conditions. So again, whenever in doubt, you could do the phase line analysis, but in general, try to get used to match different logistic equations with a standard one. Essentially, any equation of that form. And it could appear in various contexts. Here's another example. Suppose, for instance, I say, you know, you have a population in which, let me write the equation first. So let's say you have p prime equals, let's say a times p plus b times p minus mu times p squared. I'm not going to get into the meaning of that, but suppose, for example, you have different types of inputs, rates as per capita of population size. What I'm trying to point out here is that, and this will be, again, related to the death rate, you could have basically more than two constants, but as long as your equation can be written as a constant times p minus another constant times p squared, it's still a form of the logistic equation. So the analysis still works as before, except now, you know, what would be the limiting behavior in this last example, where it will be p of t approaches a plus b over mu if a plus b is greater than zero, because a plus b, this constant, plays the role of r if you look at the standard format. And in the last part of the lecture, you'll see the epidemic model, which reduces to the logistic equation. We'll talk about the interpretation shortly. So with that in mind, let's stay tuned for the third part.